to Connie Martinson Talks Books. We have pictures of movie stars, of artists, and sometimes they are absolutely gorgeous, and that's half of what makes them a star or well-known. Well, if they were fortunate, they would have been photographed by my guest, Michael Childers, who has now in the third edition a book called Icons and Legends. And even on the cover, Natalie Wood, who never looked quite that beautiful. Welcome, Michael.
Thank you. It's good to be here.
Thank you. It's wonderful to, I mean, I went through this book and there isn't a page that didn't have a fame or a face that I said, ah, they never looked that well.
Mm-hmm. Well, I try to not capture their personality. And very often the great actresses, I had to make them look wonderful, legendary. You know, I was trained by some great photographers in the 60s and 70s, and I worked with George Harrell and learned that lighting. So I can do classic Hollywood lighting or sort of modern sort of daylight, you know.
And well, I love on both. The back is certainly modern.
That was done with Andy Warhol, done in his New York studio in the early 70s. And that's daylight, you know, with a reflector, and Andy with his strange toupee on. Then later I did Andy at his apartment in Paris, one knew he had, except a few of his friends. I think he kept it hidden from the IRS, but it was fascinating.
Here is somebody, I mean, Michael Feinstein here is absolutely androgynous. Mm. I mean, he's just beautiful.
Well, what a face.
I mean, yeah.
He still looks like that. That was done in the mid-90s up at his house in Los Feliz, which I think he still has. But it's been wonderful to see Michael grow as an artist, and just, he's so good.
Here is another of Andy Warhol.
Called Andy and Fur, done in his New York studio. That's a very famous image.
And one of my favorite artists, but so unique in this painting, in this picture, because it looks like a painting, David Hockney.
David's been my friend since the end of the 60s. I met him in London, and he was my neighbor. He lives up here off of Mulholland, Woodrow Wilson, part of the year. He's just one of the world's greatest artists.
Mm-hmm. And Edith Head. And interesting is the painting in back of her, because in some of these you've made the setting fit in with the person.
Well, she had a great collection of Mexican artists in her house up in Coldwater Canyon.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's Ricardo Martinez's painting, which is a very famous painting. And she had, you know, this strong, extraordinary face and this great Indian and Santa Fe jewelry. Very stern woman, but George Cukor got me into photograph her, and I photographed her actually two or three times, because I photographed her for People magazine with all her, what did she have, 10, 12 Oscars over at Universal Studios.
Wonderful man, George Cukor.
You know, I worked with him for a year and a half up at Cordell Drive in that great famous house.
Oh, that was a great area.
Oh, yeah, it's one of the classic Hollywood houses, designed by Billy Haynes, mm-hmm. the first great Hollywood decorator. But I mean, Katharine Hepburn would be by the pool, Garbo, Spencer Tracy. I mean, it was a wonderful era of Hollywood.
Now, Anne Margaret?
That was just done a couple years ago.
Yeah, and she looks like that today.
I know, isn't she great? She's timeless. And that's her motorcycle. She really does still ride them.
Uh-huh.
And that was done out in the desert in Palm Springs where I live.
Yeah.
And I think she is wonderful to work with.
You were also the photographer and part of the National Theater in London.
Yeah, what an experience for a 24-year-old American to be on the stage at Sir Lance Olivier's National Theater, to work with some of the greatest actors of the century, like Gail Good, Ralph Richardson,
Lawrence Olivier,
Maggie Smith,
all
the greats. It was really, I could pinch myself. What great experience. I'm the only American who's ever photographed for the English National Theater.
Now, how would you photograph them? I mean, did you have a studio there?
No. Well, Well, usually I photograph the production. Then I would do set up a little studio on the side of the stage to photograph. My specialty was capturing some of the great female stars of the theater at that time. Diane Cilento and Maggie Smith, Vanessa Redgrave, and a divine funny lady called Coral Brown.
Oh, I remember.
Yeah,
Coral
of course.
Brown.
Funniest lady I ever met.
Yeah.
So I did that and would photograph like John Gielgud and Ralph Richardson in No Man's Land. We did it in a hallway, you know, near the cafeteria. That was the only place they could
what
find.
What sort of camera would you use for my friends who are camera people
watching? Well, in those days, going on location, I've used Nikon for about 40 years.
Mm-hmm.
And now with the death of film, it's so sad. I use my Canon digital. But, you know, my important work, whatever that word means, I still use film with a Mamiya RZ, which has a huge negative. And you can blow them up, beautiful silver gelatin prints, for the museums and exhibits, which I've had six shows around America this year.
You say that you also live in Santa Fe?
I did, for 9 years. I had a wonderful time there.
Yeah. A beautiful area. And, of course, what can we say about this man?
Famous Arnold. It's a famous shot. In fact, Toshin is doing a book on Arnold. They're using several pages of my photographs. I worked with Arnold on Conan and The Terminator, Stay Hungry. I've worked with him all during the early days. He has a great sense of humor. I love working with him.
Yeah. And here, of course, the beautiful Catherine Deneuve and her sister, unfortunately, who was killed in a car accident.
Françoise d'Orléac.
Yeah.
And I met her when she was doing Les Damsels de Rochefort, which was like the Catherine Deneuve did the great Jacques Demy film, Umbrellas of Cherbourg, which is all singing, and Les Damsels de Rochefort was all dancing. She was enchanting the sister. She had a much bigger personality than Catherine.
And really had a future.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was killed in a car crash.
But she in the Umbrellas of Cherbourg.
Les Parapluies de Cherbourg.
Yes. Thank you.
That picture of Catherine was taken here in Los Angeles for the cover of Los Angeles Magazine.
Uh-huh.
And I just, I worked with her twice. She was.
And let me just hold up this picture of John.
John Schlesinger, my partner of 37 years. One of the greatest British film directors.
How long ago did he pass away?
In 2003, mm-hmm. In Palm Springs.
So it's 10 years now.
Yeah, it's 10 years now.
How time does fly.
Yeah. But he's still alive. There's film festivals. There's Miami Film Festivals honoring him. There's one in London and New York. They just had Midnight Cowboy. It was voted the number one film about New York.
Oh.
That's pretty good.
Yes, especially for an Englishman. And I said to you, this picture of the dear man, Jerry.
Jerry Herman.
Yes.
That was done up at his house in Bel Air. And Jerry, I mean, Mame, La Cage aux Folles, all those great shows. Hello, Dolly with Carol Channing. He's one of the best Broadway composers of all time. And he lived in Palm Springs for like 15, 20 years, but he's moved to Miami. He's very, very happy down there.
Well, when you speak to him, please give him my regards, because I will never forget doing a show with him on his book about Broadway. And he's sitting there, and I said, Jerry, first of all, he played the piano, but then sitting there with him and talking about La Cage aux Folles, and I said, I bet as a little boy you watched your mother making up. He said, how did you know? Was it in the book? Well, you just knew that this was a boy with his mother.
Mm-hmm. With a dream.
Yeah.
Very musical. And looking over into the skyline where New York was like half an hour away from where he grew up. And he conquered New York and Hollywood, too.
Oh, and to be in New York and have two hits on Broadway.
Two hits, I remember there were three playing there at once. They had Pearl Bailey and Hello, Dolly. They had Mame and then La Cage aux Folles.
And to have him sing it is even better. Now, I'm going through here. Laurence Olivier in a very serious mood.
Very. He let me in close and close. Yeah. I came in closer and closer. And he said, he hated being photographed. But he said, my dear boy, I assume you're going for my mean upper lip. Well, which is what I was doing. I thought he would start screaming. Yeah. But, you know, because I worked at the National Theater, which he was running, he gave me access. And this was done at Paramount Pictures over on Melrose Avenue on a film called Marathon Man.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it was great fun to work
on that.
That
was a great movie, too. The other, of course, was the Entertainer. And that was, I'm looking for, the one with John, here, this group, because the book's a little heavy.
Mm-hmm.
The Four Men.
The one with Schlesinger and Dustin Hoffman, with the dental torture, which has ruined the dentistry profession for 20 years. Is it safe? Is it safe? Is he dug that drill in? And I remember in Westwood, the first screening of the preview, oh my God, the audiences were screaming, running down the aisle, because everyone identifies with dental torture.
Yep.
It was a great moment.
Yeah, and beautiful.
There's my great friend, George Harrell, I think the greatest Hollywood photographer of all time. And I photographed him several times. He used my studio over on Melrose because it was a black box, just like his old studio at MGM.
So. Who did he photograph there?
Oh, he did Bette Midler. He did several sessions with other people.
This is a period here with where you're going into more what you said, Vanity Fair, Vogue type photography.
Yeah, that was Joe D'Alessandro done in New York about 1971. And that was done for English Vogue. And English Vogue was my early mentors. I worked with them for years. And it was wonderful seeing your pictures in Vogue, beautifully art direct and laid out.
Whom do you photograph now?
Who do I photograph now? Authors. I am passionate about authors and books, and I have a show, an exhibit called Author, which is traveling around America. It's been to 14 cities. And it's all the greatest screenwriters, poets, playwrights, and authors.
Who is still alive, or?
Well, no, they're not all still alive.
I mean, because here, of course.
Gore Vidal.
Yes.
That was the last photograph taken of Gore Vidal up in Outlook at his house.
Yeah.
And I'd known Gore for 40 years, but I'm not sure if he's going to let me do it, but he said yes, and I came up there. I was a little shocked to see what physical shape he was in. He was in a wheelchair, but he's wearing his Legion d'honneur, and we said, let's do some of really great shots. And he was very affable. Didn't hurt that he was drinking red wine and vodka at 10 a.m. In the morning. So it was a wonderful session, and. Yeah. I'll never forget when he said goodbye. He gave me, he's not a very warm, demonstrative man, but he gave me a hug, and when I pulled away, he was crying. And I said, I said goodbye. I knew that was goodbye to Gore. He died about 5 months later.
Yeah.
Great author. Great author. One of the most well-read people that I've ever met in my life.
Well, I had done a show with Gore back. When he was writing something about the Bible or one of those. Uh-huh. Then he did, we did the book on Lincoln and through the years. But the last show we did talked about his dear friend who was dying at Cedars-Sinai and walking down that corridor that one does when someone you love is in the hospital. Mm. Beautiful man. Mm-hmm. I mean, he could be very acerbic.
He could be very acerbic.
Yeah.
That's the word.
Yeah.
His vocabulary was astonishing, and his knowledge of history. And, you know, I felt very intellectually inferior around Gore. Careful
this
what I had to
say.
This
is a work of art, these two pages.
That is the Palm Springs Art Museum and the Getty did a project called Backyard Oasis. And that's called the Hockney Swimmer. It's David's assistant swimming in the David Hockney pool up on Montcalm. And it's a very famous image. It's been published all over the world.
Yeah.
And by this great, great artist who painted
Pool. Is he still there now?
I think he's in town now. He just opened up the De Young Museum in San Francisco, one of his biggest shows ever.
Because you have another picture here of him sitting and looking at a picture of his parents.
Yeah, yeah. That was done in London in a studio on Powis Terrace.
Here's my...
David's a great reader. He has stacks of books. And who's that now? Oh, Dennis Hopper, one of my favorites.
Yeah.
Wonderful, a wonderful photographer, an artist, a Renaissance man, a very good actor, very witty. I just thought he was great.
Do you know, I have a painting that Dennis did. He didn't sign it, but it was when he was 21.
Oh,
and his birthday party, I don't know if you were there, his agent gave him, but it was, Dennis, it's called The Weaver.
Uh-huh.
And there's somebody in the middle of, I think he used shoe polish.
Uh-huh,
even.
Yeah.
But now we come to darling Ray Bradbury.
Ray was my first or second author. My first was Rod McEwen. Ray was my second. And I met him at UCLA. One of the greatest novelists of the 20th century, Fahrenheit 451, Martian Chronicles, and he kept writing. He died just about 2 years ago.
Right.
Yeah.
And 94. Ray was the sort, when you did maybe around 11 shows with him, he began always wearing his tennis clothes. And he would come in, and he was a dear, and even being honest enough about another writer whom he called a bad name, but the end of it was he came in the wheelchair, and I don't know if you saw him in those days.
No, I heard, yeah.
Because here he is so young, and the world is in front of him.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. I called him up about a year and a half before he died, and I said, you know, Ray, we haven't photographed in 45 years. I'd love to do another portrait. He said, you know, Michael, you made me look so good, and I'm not looking good now, and I'm not feeling good. Let's just remember me from the first photograph.
Oh.
Harvey Fierstein?
Yeah. Classic genius also.
Oh, he's so funny in that voice, which I'm starting to get now because I have a little laryngitis. But I just saw, he's got Kinky Boots on Broadway now, which he wrote. He's got two big hits on Broadway. His Newsies.
Yeah.
And Kinky Boots and Torch Song Trilogy. That photograph is from the film Torch Song Trilogy, and I did that at the studios here in Burbank.
And you have Bette Midler in the back, who's coming here now playing Sue.
Oh my gosh! Yeah. You must see. You are what you eat. I'll eat you last. That's what it's coming to the Geffen. I saw it in New York. It's brilliant, brilliant. Yeah. John Logan play is brilliant.
And that's wonderful. You don't do much color, but this with Amy Tan is perfect.
Oh, but she's so beautiful. And she's the best dressed author I ever photographed.
Yeah.
It is Yamamoto and these beautiful Comme des Garçons outfits. And I said, this is color.
Yeah.
And I loved her skin, the luminosity of her skin.
Mm-hmm.
No, she's a great writer. I'm just reading her new book now.
Yeah, I haven't read it yet.
Brand new.
Yeah. I'll ask
she's
you about it.
Fascinating lady.
Yeah. We come now to, speaking of writers, yesterday, and she looks no different than she did when you photographed her, Angelica.
I just finished her book too.
Yeah.
It's great. It's charming. I didn't know about all this stuff about Ireland. Yeah. And her early life. I thought she did a very good job on the book.
But
I can't wait to read part two, which is about Hollywood, which is going to be a wild ride.
I said to her, are you finding it more difficult to write this book than you did going back to being a child?
Uh-huh.
And she didn't want to talk about it. But here we go to dance. You love dancers.
I love dance. And when I was living in London and New York in the 70s, I worked with American Ballet Theater and Alvin Ailey and Royal Ballet. They're thoroughbreds. I love the way they move, and I learned I learned about working with actors from, you know, when you start with dancers, capturing the moment of movement, mm-hmm. which is so exciting and sensual.
How many photos would you take at one time?
Oh, hundreds, yeah. hundreds. But yeah. you know, I did the first big raunchy nude musicals, which were big in the late 60s. I did Hair, and I did Oh Calcutta, which ran
here.
16 years, yeah. my goodness.
Well, people like beautiful bodies.
Yes, they do. That's yeah. yeah.
And this one was?
That is actually from a series I did at the Louis Stern Fine Arts Gallery in Beverly Hills called Distortions. And I've shown that in various cities. It's a great series I did of male, female nudes, and even flowers done in distortion mirrors, like funhouse mirrors.
Yeah. But nothing like that. And I'm just trying to see where the Oh Calcutta is, but never mind about here. Talk about writers, Tennessee Williams.
Well, Tennessee, what a poet. A total over-the-top poet and funny.
And a bit of a character when
a
you met him.
Real character.
Yeah.
Well, I just saw his Glass Menagerie in New York with Terry Jones. It's the best production of Glass Menagerie I've ever seen.
Really?
I've seen it about 10 times. It's just superb. And it just shows the power of his writing. When it's done well, it doesn't age.
Yeah.
His play was written, what, in 1944? It doesn't age, it's timeless. Yeah. And he's a great character.
Yeah.
He'd just been to Dr. Jacob, who all the New York intelligentsia used to go to for their the vitamin B12 and the speed shots, like Leonard Bernstein.
Yeah.
And he was flying, and he's holding his Jack Daniels just below that shot. He was flying, but he trusted me, gave me a great, great
Oh, he was a charmer,
yeah,
though.
Yeah,
he was charming.
I love the way he talked like that, and that Southern.
Now, anybody who knows clothes and design, a true artist,
the
James
great
Galanos.
James Galanos.
Yeah.
The only American couturier. He's just considered one of the geniuses of the 20th century, what he did in fashion. And I got to know him in Palm Springs, how lucky I am, and that was Taken's house in Palm Springs. There's a secret about Mr. Galanos, and that he, in the last 5 years, has become a great photographer.
Oh, really?
Doing beautiful still lifes. They're just gorgeous. You know?
Yeah. He had a beautiful model, Pat Jones.
Oh, yes, yeah.
And Pat was really incredible, too. The architect of Los Angeles.
Richard Meyer.
Yes.
Yes. That was done up at the Getty. And when the magazine, I think it was English Vogue, called me, they said, we want a great, great portrait of Mr. Meyer up at the museum. So I spent three days doing Polaroids up there and getting the angles. And I chose this. And I was told by his secretary, he's not in a great humor today, and we all only have him for 5 minutes.
Yeah.
Well, he got up there, and he looked at the Polaroid I did of him, and he said, I like these, let's do some more. And he stayed for 45 minutes.
Yeah.
It was a great session. It was starting to rain, it was very windy up on the great Getty Museum, Acropolis Hill, but he was...
got the movement of the
building,
because it's so in contrast to the really almost New Englandish look to him, and to have that almost like music in the background.
Well, I love architects. I mean, I don't photograph film stars anymore. I did that for long enough, but authors and architects and artist friends.
And
so exciting.
The late.
The great Robert Graham.
Yeah.
Really one of the greatest West Coast artists and a great sculptor and a real Renaissance man. Very, very private. And one of the great faces. Look at that face with that hair. And that was his studio down in Venice.
And even with the nude.
Do you know that's Brooke Shields in the nude? In the nude sculpture.
Oh, really?
The first one, that's Brooke Shields. Yeah, they're great friends,
Well, but whoever it was, you know, it's almost like a Roman's bust.
Yes, the whole collection.
Yeah, and even, I assume you set him up that way.
Yeah, I did.
And do you know, I'm still looking for Angelica here. and I...
She's in there, my Angelica.
Yes,
yeah,
she is.
She's a great lady.
And
she's so beautiful.
Yes,
striking.
She is.
It's all the, I've known her since 1969, and yeah. She's just that, her journey through life has been really very interesting.
Totally.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I hope she gets a chance to have you do her again.
I'd love
because
to, yeah.
You have her here with the open blouse. She was that way yesterday.
That was the look in the late 70s. And
yeah.
I call it the rich hippie phase, you know.
Okay. Who photographs you?
Who photographs me?
Yes.
Well, I've had Greg Gorman's a wonderful photographer friend of mine.
Yeah.
He's probably done the best pictures of me. He's
yeah.
a superb photographer. And in fact, we're honoring him. I'm involved with it at the Palm Springs Art Fair.
And,
February, they're honoring Greg Gorman. I'm very, very pleased.
You do something else called One Night Only.
One Night Only.
Yes.
Which is a charity show I've done for 12 years now. And it's done for the Jewish Family Service in Palm Springs. And it's 20, 25 Broadway stars that come in from New York. And I have fun because
yeah.
it's everyone I ever wanted to work with on Broadway.
Yeah.
And do it, it's great.
Well, I know when it's coming because I have this. And I would love to
come down and see
I
it.
I will come
yeah,
down and
great.
See. Michael, I feel I've known you because I know the pictures,
yeah.
and I love them. Will you autograph my book?
I would love to.
And if you'd like to know what else we've been reading and seeing, visit me on the web at www.ConnieMartinson.com. Visit us on YouTube, where you will be able to see this show again, and support your local library. Libraries have great photographic collections. I was just saying, Yusuf Karsh, he's the man who took the cigar out of Churchill's mouth to get that look that sort of saved a country during World War II. And it's worth, go there, ask, and take some people with you like a child, and we'll see you next time. Thank you
Thank
so
you.
Much, Michael.
It's been a pleasure.